in terms of the intellectual, epistemic, and the political inception of the book?
Okay. Now, first, let me please. I mean, again, not just the sake of reciprocating. I just want to say, and I'll say it short. First of all, I'm humbled by Hamid's introduction. And B, I'll just say this. I've known Hamid for 20 years now, since my first graduate year at NYU. Then he was hijacked to Columbia University, which kind of prevented me to work with him on a more regular basis, but we've been in very close contact in the past 20 years, and he's always been a source of inspiration, both his persona and his academic work. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
As to your question, well, I've read an op-ed by Harvard president a couple of weeks ago. I'm sure that some of you have read it at the New York Times. And I think the title was "The University's Crisis of Purpose." And the first paragraph, which I wrote down because I think it is extremely important. She writes as follows: American universities have long struggled to meet almost irreconcilable demands, to be practical as well as transcendent, to assist immediate national needs, and to pursue knowledge for its own sake, to both add values and question values. Which is, I think, kind of encapsulates very neatly the dilemma of the university in our modern age. Coming from Israel in general, and coming from my home university, Ben Gurion University in particular, which I extremely like, I mean, it has been good to me, I've been bad to it, it's been good to me. I think that this dilemma, which mentions, has been solved in many ways insofar as Israeli universities are concerned and insofar as Middle East studies are concerned. Because in Israel, generally speaking, when it comes to the social sciences or the humanities in general, when it comes to Middle East studies in particular, scholarship tends to very easily cross the boundary between academic research and the needs of the state, the ethnocentric, the strategic, the political needs of the state. And thus, especially when it comes to Middle East studies, you get a rather official takes on the Middle East. I mean, Israeli scholars, by and large, when it comes to the Middle East, when they write, when they think about their subject, when they think about their topics, what they have before their eyes is usually the policy needs of the state of Israel. And thus, as I said before, they have no compunction about at crossing all the time the very porous boundaries between their intellectual mission, which is, of course, to critique, to resist power, to question conventional wisdoms, and, of course, the policy security needs of the state of Israel. And thus, scholarship on the Middle East and Iran tends to kind of join hands together with the media and with the political establishments to disseminate certain view of the Middle East in general and of Iran in particular. So I was very much troubled by, as a historian of Iran who's been working for, again, 20 years on the modern history of Iran in the 20th century, before and after the revolution, I was very much troubled by that phenomenon, which, of course, and this happens here as well, creates distorted images of anything Oriental, and of anything Iranian. So that was, I think, the starting point where I thought about writing. think that a turning point came about in 1996 when I gave an interview to Haaretz Weekly Supplement, in which I essentially said three things. Again, one is that the Middle East studies community in Israel is very much intertwined with policy institutions and the needs and the policy needs of the state of Israel. B, and that was with that in 1996, things have changed a little bit for the better, but my second argument was that the Middle East studies community in Israel is practically impervious to any of the methodological methodologies and insightful arguments made in other fields of social sciences and humanities. And the third argument, which was the most blasphemous thing, for which I almost lost my job, but here I am, I survived, so don't worry about it, was that you know, Israel and Iran are not that different as one might have us believe. Especially, I can say here, this is very general, because we probably don't have time to get into it in more detail, especially when it comes to the interpenetration between nation and religion, state and religion, and also politics of identity. That was the little did I know at the time, being untenured, young, faculty member of the university, that of the baggage that would follow. Again, now looking back, it was a tempest in a teacup, but for me back then it was quite a major crisis. There were demands, both the university authorities and political service, to have me dismissed, unlike the warden, I had no tenure then. But I survived, and I think that the idea of writing a book, I think, came about then. One more reason, I think, has to do with the fact that I was very much frustrated with the most scholarly works on Iran and Israel that tend to look at the relationships and crisis between the two countries, again, merely through strategic lens, geopolitical lens, and political lens, and I thought that cultural study, or study anchored in culture, would be something that I think would be beneficial. So there, then it all began.
Then what was the immediate reaction? What was the context in terms of, especially given the contemporary urgency of the Iran-Israeli hostilities and rhetorics and so forth? How was
this book or the Hebrew? Because
the Hebrew, yeah. The Hebrew original.
Okay, here we have a very, interesting phenomenon. On the one hand, the Middle East studies community completely ignored the book, as though it is non-existent, which for me was a great compliment, I think, because they did not quite know how to deal with it. So it was resounding silence. No one wanted to talk about it. No one had any wish to see conference or talks about it, to even to debate. On the other hand, we had historians of Europe, sociologists, who were keenly interested in the book. And it also received very good reviews by those historians and anthropologists. The Hebrew version of the book was translated to Arabic in 2007, and it won very favorable reviews in the Arab electronic
Was it translated in Israel?
In Ramallah, by the Center for Palestine, for Israeli Studies, in Ramallah. And there were some very, very good reviews, which again, because of that, I was determined to translate the Hebrew version into this text. But then, as you know, usually happens to